Paul, so I'm glad you could join us today. It's a little bit after 11, so we're going to go ahead and get started with our monthly webinar. And here at Agent, most of you know, we manage special needs trusts. So all of our clients are either seniors or persons with disabilities. So our topic today on Social Security is very relevant. And I wanted to let you know that you will be receiving continuing ed credits for the guardians, attorneys, and the certified senior advisors today. So Kate will be sending you an email within a week with a link to go ahead and get your, certificate. And we will, of course, upload the guardianship of credits for you. But there will be certificates available also. And Brandon and Mike have been kind enough to allow us to post their presentation to our Aged webinar website after the meeting. And you can look at it there. And if you know anybody that wasn't able to attend today, they'll be able to actually review that and answer questions and get credit also for that. So we ask you to put your questions into chat today. There'll be plenty of time to answer the questions after the presentation is done. So I would just briefly like to introduce our speakers and again thank them for joining us today. Michael Allen is the Managing Director of Security Financial Management since 1998. And he has Brandon with him. And Mike, I'm just going to let you kind of do your introduction from here. So thank you.
Oh, great. Thank you so much, Sharon. We really appreciate Agent Trust inviting us to be a part of their educational webinars. It's so great, and they provide a great service for their community. And we have offices in Central, West, and Northeast Florida. We've been working with clients since just under 40 years and serving the special needs community since 1992. And as Sharon said, I've been in the business since 1998. Special needs planning was one of the big reasons I got into the industry with my brother and our partner Frank. We used to do webinar or seminars. We don't do them as much now. We can, but we just do special needs planning seminars at for the Down Syndrome Association, autism organizations, NAMI, etc. And so we have a really good knowledge, and we still have a lot of clients that with family members that have special needs. It's just a really important area for us. And then also, as far as the senior planning, we have a lot of clients that are senior and many that are on their way. And one of these days I'll be there too. I think Brandon, you're pretty close to being a senior, right? Now Brandon Condit is with Nationwide. He's the managing regional vice president of Nationwide, and he and his company provide vital resources and products to help us better serve our clients. We've been working with Nationwide for a really long time, and with Brandon through two different companies. So, Brandon, how long has it been since we've been working together?
Yeah, Mike, I've been in the industry since 2010, so I guess we would say 2011. We've known each other for that long. So, yeah, about 13
Time
years.
flies by. Time flies on by. I didn't mention it, but I hope everybody has recovered well from the hurricane. Brandon is still recovering from the hurricane. As you can see, he is at a friend's lanai because he has no power over in Tampa. So he's handling it like a champ, though. So SFM, Security Financial Management, we have 17 advisors across all of our offices and a great support staff along with that. And we love our clients, and we love working and collaborating with professionals across the industry: estate planning attorney, tax advisors, guardians, caregivers, and obviously family members too, to make sure that we're giving a well-rounded plan for our clients and have a well-rounded team as well. Because there's many times we don't know everything. We know a lot, but not everything. And the way we look at special needs planning is it's like a three-legged stool. It's the financial plan, the estate plan, and the letter of intent. Without one of those legs, it all falls apart. And we don't want that. So we need to work together. And it's ongoing too. Letter of intent, I've seen very few clients have done that. And I'm sure you all have seen where people have the legal side done but they don't have the loving side done, and the letter of intent really helps. So we are fiduciaries for our clients, and we want to make sure that we are assisting them and guiding them in all aspects of their lives, financial and non-financial. So during our seminar today, though, we're going to be focusing basically on the broad strokes security, Social Security planning. We'll mention some special needs in there, but not get too deep into it. If we don't address a certain need or a question, obviously you can chat, but we can also schedule one-on-one meetings, webinars, phone calls in person at one of our various offices, where we can address that with U.S. professionals or also family, your clients too. So, without further ado, I'm going to let Brandon go over the webinar, and I'm going to chime in as we go along.
Awesome. Thanks, Mike. And thank you, everybody, for having me here today, this morning. If this light gets a little distracting, just let me know. I know it's pretty bright here, but luckily we're getting a nice little cool wave going through here. So it feels good sitting out here right now. But I'll go ahead and share my screen. And while I'm sharing my screen, just briefly explain who I am. So I work with financial advisors throughout the state of Florida. And my job during the day is we have products and lines called annuities, right? So I'm out educating advisors on the broad strokes of annuities. How do they work? How do they change? But on the flip side of that, I'm also a certified retirement counselor. So one of the big things along with Social Security that we're pretty well versed in is also Medicare, right? Another big topic for pre-retirees and retirees is Medicare. So another good webinar that we have, maybe we could do one down the road on that. But all things considered, I'd love to jump in here and kind of get right to it just to be cognizant of time. Some of this stuff, may look a little arbitrary. So I will go through some of this a little bit quickly. And if you have any questions throughout, please do not hesitate to raise your hand or shoot it in the chat, and we'll get them answered. So we'll go ahead and we'll dive right in. So Social Security, as you know, I mean, it's a choice of a lifetime. And we're going to go over, here's the three things, and I'm going to block this here so I'm not seeing this the whole time. Let me minimize this. We're going to go over, again, making the decision. And the thing that we want to make very clear is that, let's try not to make this an emotional decision, but a financial decision, right? So that we'll talk about that. Then we'll go over the basics, right? And then we're going to talk about the guidance. And that's where Mike is going to come in and kind of guiding us on the best way to go about doing this, right? So the first thing you're going to see here is just how big of a difference it can make to a person's longevity of income when they're collecting Social Security, right? So this little chart here is showing you an individual who averaged $54,000 a year. If they were to start benefits at age 62, as you could see, they'd be getting about $1,465. Adversely, as you probably are all well aware, you can wait as long as age 70 to collect benefits. Again, we're not advocating waiting, right? We don't, it's totally, again, each situation is unique to in every individual. But you can see that it can be a big difference, right? So we're going to go through a couple slides on that. Go ahead, Mike.
Or the choice of the lifetime.
Okay.
I can't control that.
I thought you were saying something. I apologize.
Oh, no.
All right. So let's talk a little bit about the numbers, right? So I'm sure, as most of us know, right? The earliest you can turn on Social Security benefits would be at age 62, unless it's Social Security disability. So this slide just shows, as you can see, more than about 50% of people end up turning on their benefits before full retirement age, right? And for most individuals on the call today, it's probably between 66 and most likely 67 for what your full retirement age is. But I like this slide. It just shows, similar to what Mike said, we look at Social Security kind of as a three-legged stool, and what it was designed to be back when it was invented to what it's being used for today, it's kind of got some pitfalls in it. And we're going to kind of go into that in just a second. So the next couple slides are going to give you a couple examples. The first one here is of a married couple. And all of these numbers that you see here is off of the assumption of normal life expectancy. So effective 2024, I think you all know, people are living longer and longer, right? So that's a good thing, right? So the average life expectancy for a male today is 85 and for a female is age 88. So that's where these numbers are coming from when we give these payouts and this income stream that you're going to see. So we're breaking this down. As you see, Pat 66 in this example and is entitled 2600. Kelly's 61, so she couldn't file till next year at 62. But we're going to kind of break that down, right? So if they both turn on benefits as soon as they possibly could, and again, living to normal life expectancy, that's a big chunk of change, right? $1.4 million is what they could expect to collect, assuming they live to 85 and 88 respectively, right? But if you look at that, if they waited to optimize their benefit, right? Hypothetically waiting till age 70, right? They could have accumulated about $227,000, right? Additionally, if they had waited. So the big thing I'll tell you, and all the tools and calculators we have available to us, guys, the big thing is family history. I think we all know that, right? If your family history says, hey, mom and dad didn't make it past 60, I'm probably turning on the benefits sooner than later, right? But again, making this more of a non-emotional decision is very key when we're making these decisions, right?
We'll probably cover this later, but also we're not, if you're married, you're not just thinking about yourself.
Correct.
You're thinking of the survivor, your spouse. So if you elect Social Security early, it affects them as well.
Absolutely. So absolutely. And we do see a lot of people, maybe a primary breadwinner or primary wage earner, they may wait till 70 just to maximize the benefit for when they possibly predecease their spouse, right? So that's something that you're exactly right. That's got to be part of the plan when filing for benefits. So here's just a quick example of Mary, single. Her full retirement benefit is age 67. What would the differences look like for Mary? For Mary, you see here, she files at age 62, lives normal life expectancy. She could collect about 353. If she waited till full retirement age, as we said, 67, she'd be collecting 432. And then if she waited again, let's look at this, age 70, it'd be about $478,000. So, just a couple slides. I think it's important to see, right? And again, each month matters. That's what I tell people, right? So every single month, if you start at 62, or if you start at age 62 in 6 months, right, you get a little bit of a benefit each month that you wait in either the reduction, or on the flip side of that, if you're waiting past full retirement age, each month matters on the possible additional income you could get on the flip side of that. Obviously, you know, and I've done a lot of these seminars, I've had two people in my 11 years that have raised their hand and said, hey, I'm still deferring my Social Security. One gentleman was actually 72 years old. I told him to immediately go and call Social Security. There is no advantage to waiting past age 70, right? So I just wanted that to be thrown out there. Normally, in that special situation, I actually caught back up with that client, and they were actually nice enough to back pay them for the 2 years of missed payments. But that is not guaranteed. So just keep that in the back of your mind. You or a friend, no reason to wait past age 70.
We had a couple come in one time who they were both over 70, and the spouse didn't claim because they thought she wasn't eligible. She would have got 50%. And so eventually they did. I don't know if they caught back up with that, but they did finally elected for her to get Social Security, but wasn't a good move. As and in regards to, you know, taking it early or using the funds to invest in your portfolio, I'll address that since we're kind of in that area already. Pam is asking that question, and you know, you're getting an 8% rate of return on your by deferring. So every year you wait, it's 8%. So it's, you know, in today's world, it's hard to beat that, especially if you're in a well-diversified, balanced, conservative portfolio. I wish I could guarantee that 8% rate of return, but it's going to be hard to do. But Pam, if you want to look at the details and go deeper into that, we can talk later. Also, we do for our clients is we run the financial plan, and we talk about this stuff all the time up to the very day that they oftentimes when they elect Social Security. Another thing is when you have Social Security, like say if you elected early and you're still working, definitely doesn't make sense most of the time, because every dollar you make is going to decrease the amount that you're getting from Social Security.
That's exactly right, Mike. And there's a couple slides coming up here towards the tail end of this that explain kind of the pitfalls if you decide to collect early and you're still working and making a certain amount of money that can affect your long-term payments, right? So, all right. So this slide, as I said before, when Social Security was designed, it was kind of like, hey, we're Social Security. We plan to cover one third of your retirement income, right? And the way that that three-legged stool was supposed to work was Social Security one third, pensions one third, and then personal savings one third. You guys obviously know the wobbly leg of that stool is pensions have gone the way of the dodo bird, right? For most individuals, if you have a pension on here, you may have been requested to be a buyout in it. But for example, for me, we don't have a pension plan. It's all 401ks, right? So the point is it's Social Security dollars are being stretched even further. And as you can see by this slide, for most, Americans out there, it makes up about 52% of their retirement income, right? Which can be, unfortunately, a struggle for many, many people, right? So, yeah, I like this slide. Again, it's not my favorite slide, but at the same time, it just reiterates that Social Security is very much and heavily relied on. All right, now we're going to jump into the basics. So, what is Social Security? I don't think you guys need me to go over this. It's guaranteed lifetime income. It's indexed for inflation. It gives you survivor's benefits, right? And then there is tax, preferential tax treatment that we'll talk about as well. So I usually, when I'm doing this in person, I do a little quick Q&A, but I know it's a little harder on these Zooms. But so Social Security and Act went in live back in 1935, and actually Ida Mae Fuller was the first recipient of that check, right? And her check was $24, right? And some fun stats on Miss Ida Mae. So she got her first paycheck in 1940. She paid 3 years into the Social Security system, and she paid $24 is what she paid into the system over her 3 years of paying into the system. And actually, to Ida Mae's fortune, she lived to be 101 years old. She collected from Social Security only, think about this, only putting in $24 of her earned income. She collected over $28,000 of income from Social Security. So again, longevity in your favor, this works out, but this was something that went live. It was signed into law back in 1935, and the first paycheck started going out in 1940.
Brandon, the life expectancy back then was about 61, wasn't it?
Yeah, it's funny. And actually, back then you still couldn't, there was no filing early, Mike. And do you know what full retirement age was back in 1940 when checks were going out?
Know what?
It was 65. So as
Yeah.
you can see, right now, today in 2024, the full retirement age is 67, right? So obviously now we can file at early at age 62. But if you ask me, and that's a whole nother conversation about pitfalls with Social Security, it's not a surprise, guys, that we're gonna have to increase that full retirement age out, right? General rule of thumb, and this comes from the SSA website. If you're born, or excuse me, if you're currently age 55 or older, pretty safe to play by the rules that are already in place for full retirement age of age 67. But they do have a little disclaimer that if you're younger than 55, there could be, hey, maybe full retirement age, like I'm 36. I know Mike mentioned that earlier. I'm not expecting my full retirement age to be 67, right? Because there's got to be solvency in the program, and there's got to be, there's going to just keep pushing out. So great point. So
Did you guys have a your life expectancy? You guys have had it's what did you say you're projecting now?
what are we projecting?
Or for Social Security, what is the average life expectancy now? Did
Well,
you do
average
that?
life expectancy. Yeah, average life expectancy for males is 85 and
Right.
88 for females.
Yeah, that hadn't changed much in the last few years.
It's come up a little bit, right? I remember when I first started in the industry, it was like 82 and 85. So yeah, a couple of years, it's accelerated a little bit.
Yeah, and again, back when it started, males were 61 because they knocked us off early,
Yeah.
and then 65 was for females.
Well, and I'll tell you, it was such a, you know, Social Security did so well for many, many years. To your point, we had people paying into the system and then never getting the opportunity to collect from the system. So that we had a nice surplus for many, many years, and that's kind of teeter-tottered, right? So yeah, something that definitely needs to be addressed. So the first thing you know that you're seeing here, and this is a common misconception, is you know, a lot of people think, because when you do think of pension plans, typically the way they determine your payout, right, for social or for pensions is based off of your last 5 years of earnings at a company, or last 10 years at the company, which are normally your highest wage earning years. The way Social Security determines your payment, right? Because you know, we used to get those statements every year, remember, Mike? But now you don't get them until age 60 every single year. But the thing that you know, the common thing that people think is how, or what they need to know is, how do they determine my benefit, right? So what they're doing is they're taking your highest 35 wage earning years and they put it into a formula, and that's what's determining what your full retirement amount will be at age 67, or whatever your full retirement amount is, right? So something to consider, right? I get the question a lot. Hey, Brandon, I took some time off out of the workforce and I've only worked and paid into the system for 25 years, let's say. Again, don't kill the messenger. I don't work for SSA. But the way that they would determine yours is they would give you zeros, plugging in for the remaining 10 years of missed years of income, which would unfortunately drag your average down, right? And on the flip side of that is, let's say you worked 40 years in the system, they would eliminate the lowest 5 wage earning years to help increase your average. Does that make sense? I know we can't really speak, but that's just the way that Social Security determines what your monthly amount is going to be. All right, I went over this with you folks earlier. This should be obviously everybody on the call today. If you're born 1960 or later, your full retirement age currently is age 67. Went over this. Mike did a great job of explaining this. You're getting an 8% increase if you wait past age 67. So pretty unique slide, just to show you guys, hey, what are the reductions if I start early versus if I take it at age 70. Here's another thing, right? And you're gonna
So,
know. Go ahead, Mike.
if you're just looking at yourself, there is a break-even point. Brandon, I think it's like 78, I think, is the break-even point
Yep.
if you wait. Again, if there's a spouse involved, all things change as far as things change big time. And that's where it's really important to run the financial plan and look at it.
Yep. So as we said before, you know, benefits are usually adjusted for inflation. You see, there's 3 years over the past 30 or so years where they did not adjust for inflation. So it's not a guarantee that they adjust for inflation. This is the cost of living adjustment. But what we're finding, and I'm sure you guys, if anybody is collecting on the call, typically the adjustment ends up being just enough to cover what the rise in healthcare costs ends up being, right? So, you know, they don't have to increase by with a COLA increase each year, but normally it does. Okay, now we're going to jump into some of the different filing, you know, basics on if you're married, if you're single, divorced, and so on and so forth. But this one here is if you're a married couple. As we mentioned, 62 is the earliest you can turn on benefits. If you want to file off of your spouse, you have to be married for at least 1 year. The big thing on this one is you cannot file off of your spouse's benefit unless they have filed themselves. Okay. And what this means is you are eligible for up to 50% of your spouse's benefit. So if my benefit's $1,000, and let's say my wife's working benefit was only going to be $300, she would jump up to 500 because she's eligible to the better of her own benefit or half of my benefit, which in that example, we'd be bringing in a household income of $1,500. Now, if I die, if I predecease, right, she loses the smaller lump sum goes away. So the 500 goes away. She will jump up to the 1,000. So no matter how you slice it, you're going to have some lost income, but point is you now are eligible to jump to the higher payout in that example, which would be 1,000. All right, moving on. So this one is unique, in that this is for surviving spouses, also known as widow's benefits, where this is the only benefit that you can take earlier than age 62. You're eligible to take as early as age 60, okay? So obviously, if you take widow's benefits, right, you can do that. It's just going to be at a reduced amount of up to 70%, right? But the thing here is you can take as early as age 70, or excuse me, as early as age 60, all right? So the thing to consider on this one that also makes this one unique is you can take your deceased spouse's payments, and if you have your own working history, you can flip-flop your benefits down the road. So I see a lot of people, and Mike, I'm sure you've seen this as well, where I'm going to collect my deceased payments, and then I'm going to defer my own working benefits to age maybe 70, and then it's higher and you can flip the script and take your own working benefit at that time because you've maxed out your benefit. Sometimes it works out, sometimes it doesn't work out. It depends, but surviving spouses is the one unique one where you can come in as early as age 60 and collect off of your deceased spouse.
It doesn't matter how many times you were married either. If you were married, for example, I have a client who was married for over 10 years and her husband unfortunately passed away. And then later she elected benefits at age 60 based on his Social Security. However, she was married again for over 10 years to another gentleman, and he passed away. And I'm like, you know what? Let's see what his benefit was. So she was able to hop from her former spouse's benefit to her more recent spouse's survivor benefit and got a raise. And she's probably not going to, she hasn't elected her own, but we're running the numbers to see if it even makes sense. Social Security won't, I don't believe they'll let you just switch over if you're going to get hurt. You can run analysis and everything to see if waiting until age 70 helps. But so again, she got a raise because she had two spouses who passed away. And she was able, if she had three spouses that passed away, she can pick and choose the best one, which is amazing. And we often wonder why Social Security is in the state it is. Those are probably some of the reasons why. But at the same time, why not take advantage of it if you can?
Yeah, 100%. And Mike brings up a great point. And that's also why you see some individuals maybe don't get remarried, right? Maybe you're collecting off of a deceased spouse. The one thing, as you see the little disclaimer here, if you get remarried before age 60, you are now with new husband, new wife's benefit, okay? So obviously, if you marry after age 60, you can still have that choice, kind of what Mike had mentioned there. But we see it a lot where, you know, it shouldn't be in the consideration. But if you get remarried, let's say hypothetically at age 55, and you were maybe planning on taking off of your first spouse's, you cannot at that point. If you're currently married, you're now with new husband, new wife, and their working history. So great, great call out there, Mike. All right, so for divorced spouses, right? So here's some of the eligibility requirements. Married for at least 10 years. So that's the big one, right? You have to be at least married to that individual for 10 years. Currently unmarried, right? As I said before, if you get remarried before 59, you're with new husband, new wife. The big difference on this one versus the traditional spousal benefits is, and they call it the spite rule. I know it's kind of goofy, but it used to be the same exact way of spousal benefits where I can't collect off of my spouse's benefit until they turned on benefits, right? Well, what was happening, as you guys know, because people can be petty, people weren't turning on their benefits, husbands or wives, because they didn't want their ex-spouse to be eligible to file off of their benefits. All that being said, it makes no impact on the spouse's, you know, benefit. But again, people can be petty, right? So the big differentiator here is even if your ex-spouse has not filed for benefits, it means no bearing. As long as you're age 62 and again, meet the criteria, you are eligible for collecting off of their working history. Anything you want to add to that, Mike?
No, not at this point in time.
Cool. So this is a big one. That's a big demographic, I'm sure, for some of us on the call. You are eligible, and one of the biggest growing demographics amongst people turning 100 is also grandparents taking care of being legal guardians of grandchildren, right? So you, there are some benefits out there. If you are a legal guardian of a dependent under age 18 or of a disabled dependent, you know, currently before age 22, they are entitled benefits. As you can see here, 50% of your PIA or 75 if it's a disabled person. Here's another slide, guys, that is really not as common. And there's actually some laws out there that are trying to get rid of these two provisions. And Mike, I know we've talked about this before. There's two.
And Sharon's asking, I believe this is what she's asking about on the chat. And the chat, you know, if I see questions that can be answered as it's flowing with the webinar, it works out great too. And like we said, if anything doesn't get answered, you can chat later and we can try to answer when the presentation is done. But I'll let you talk about this though.
Yeah, absolutely. And then the presentation's almost, we got a couple more slides left. I'd rather get to Q&A and get some questions answered. So this is obviously for government employees, people who have worked in both the private and public sector. There's two things called windfall elimination provision, and then there's something called the government pension offset. So this PowerPoint, guys, because this is the basics of Social Security, we don't dig too deep into it, but I can give you a general idea. The windfall elimination means I've worked 20 years paying into Social Security, but let's say I've worked 20 years for the government or a state funded where I was not paying into Social Security. There could be a reduction. They're going to look at whatever pension you may be getting, right, from working in the private sector, right? And then they're going to recalculate it. It can't be any more than half of what you're earning. But basically what Social Security is saying is they call it double dipping, right? They don't want you getting you're not going to be accessed to your full benefit of Social Security because you're also getting a quote unquote government pension. So they're going to do a little formula. It's called the windfall elimination provision. And that really pertains to the working individual that has worked in both sectors. Okay. I know that's a high level, as opposed to the government pension offset is really pertaining to, let's pretend I worked in the government sector my whole life and I'm going to be getting a pension. But my wife has worked in the private or in the Social Security arena where I'm expecting what? As I said before, I'm entitled to half of my wife's benefit, right? Half of your spouse's benefit. Again, they're going to look at this and say, okay, Brandon worked his whole career in the government sector. He's getting a nice pension. He's not going to be entitled to the half of his wife's working benefit. They're going to recalculate it. In some cases, I might not be eligible for any of her benefit, but other cases, it's a reduced amount. Do you have anything you want to add to that, Mike?
No, we're good. I do. We have advanced planning teams too that we can first off run into financial plan where if there's a survivor, it shows what their benefit is, what, you know, because there may be times where a survivor, even if the spouse has the WEP, where the survivor may be able to have some benefits if they pass away. But again, it's very complicated, and we put it in the financial plan, make sure that we're doing it correctly, and we also can bounce it off nationwide where they have a retirement planning center as well.
Absolutely. Yep. So moving on, just the last couple slides here. Mike mentioned this earlier, turning on Social Security benefits while you're still working. There are some pitfalls with that. Again, let's assume 67 is your full retirement age. If you turn on benefits before the final year, which would be 66 to 67, that's this middle one here. I'm going to talk about if under FRA for the full year, they're going to reduce your benefits $1 for every two. And the max earning that you could make without getting this $1 for two threshold is $22,320. So I know Mike and I, in my line of work, I have a lot of individuals who turned on benefits early and they're working a part-time job and their primary focus is to keep their earnings under this number, right? So that way it doesn't affect their Social Security. In that final year, you know, going into, again, 66 to 67, They give you a little break, we'll call it. It's a $1 for three reduction. But more importantly, you can have some higher earned income, roughly $60,000. So we do see a lot of individuals that might turn on Social Security in that final year before full retirement age, knowing, hey, I'm not going to make above that 59,000 number. And it has no bearing on their Social Security. After you obtain full retirement age, you can make and earn as much as you possibly can. It makes no bearing on what's going to happen to your Social Security check. All right, so taxation. I think as we all know, guys, I'm not a tax expert. I don't want to throw that. I got to throw that disclaimer out there. But the thing that you're going to know is obviously they're taking this out of our paychecks as we're working in our working life. And it can be taxable on the way out, right? So what I'm showing you here is this is taxable retirement income on this column, partially taxable in Social Security, as you see, falls into that mix. It's all depending on the amount of earned income or pension income that you have coming in, or we'll call it quote unquote retirement income. That's going to determine if your Social Security is taxable. As you see here, it says up to 85% taxed. It's not at an 85% tax rate. It is taxed at your ordinary income tax, but it depends on how much you have coming in. That's going to determine how much is taxable to you in the given year. So that's a high level on taxation. Definitely see a CPA regarding that, or Mike. Mike is a financial professional that can go over those. And honestly, that's why you probably see, let's take a larger withdrawal into the next calendar year or something to that effect. So if you got any insight on that, Mike, feel free to chime in.
No, you just keep going. We're good.
Awesome. So that's it, guys. So guidance built for you. Couple takeaways, right? Where we can help is the when and the how to file for Social Security. We'd be happy to walk you through that. Learn how to claim benefits for other family members. We'd be happy to do that for you. And then consider your filing decision within the big picture. Again, making this a financial decision, not necessarily an emotional decision. So now we will open it up to any questions. And I, again, really just appreciate your time. I'll stop sharing the slide.
I think that we've answered a lot of the questions. There was one question regarding if a child is getting benefit and turns 18 years old, I believe it was 18, didn't necessarily say an age, while in school, say in February, and graduates in later, like in August. I just looked this up. Google is a great thing, guys. But I have run into this situation. I have a friend and a client whose husband passed away when the kids were in elementary school, and then they were collecting Social Security all the way through until they graduated. Unfortunately, one of the girls decided that she wasn't going to finish high school. So that took a big chunk of money out of the mother's pocket. Hopefully she pays her back someday. I don't think that'll happen. So this is what I have here is if the child is still in elementary school or secondary school, once he turns 18, hopefully he's not in elementary school and he's 18 years old. He can continue receiving benefits until he graduates or turns age 19, whichever comes first. So 3 months before the child's 18th birthday, you'll receive a notice that the benefits will end. What's another question here? Pam, regarding your question, if you're having a difficult time handling, it's kind of a detailed question. If you're already working on it and you're having issues with it, maybe it might be good for us to reach out to your Nationwide's retirement planning team to see if, Brandon, I don't know if you can see the question.
I'm looking at Pam's first question. It says to take earlier and put into investments. Is that the one you're looking at, or which one are you?
Yeah, I think we covered that one.
Okay.
Pam, you let us know if you have any more questions about that one. But the second one is my current situation in New Ward currently gets $339 approximately 10 years ago. Social Security was applied for at the rehab. As single, never married. She was nonverbal, and basically she was eligible because for spousal coverage, survivor, and missed 10 years with $1,700.
Wow.
So Pam's petitioning. Pam, if you run across any issues after petitioning, there are attorneys that specialize in Social Security. One that I work with is Brad Davis. There may be I don't know, Pam, are you a, I don't know if you're a guardian or if you're an estate plan attorney, but we do have many attorneys that handle this stuff. Again, Brad Davis is one of the attorneys we work with a lot. He's helped. So, Pam, I see you are a guardian. If you don't have an attorney to go to, I can point you to one.
Yeah, Pam, that's a very unique situation. This would be what Mike mentioned. We have SSA folks on retainer here with Nationwide. I would default back. That's a unique question. So I'm sorry, I don't want to. That's a lot. So
Brandon, Sharon, it is. Sharon wants to know a little bit more about the taxation. Says, can you talk a little bit more about taxation of Social Security benefits if it's sometime not taxable, and if you are moved, is it sometime not taxable? Do you have to file a tax return? There's sometimes if somebody's just taking Social Security and that's all they're living on, there may be no requirement for to file a tax return. But again, that's getting kind of in the weeds as far as tax advice. And I would rather have you speak to a CPA, or we can ask one of our CPAs on that. But again, I have seen that people that are just taking Social Security aren't necessarily having to file taxes.
no, 100%. And it depends on how much you're bringing in from investment income, right, Mike? I mean, that's normally what it's going to determine. If you're pulling in, I'm trying to find the limits. I apologize. I'm trying to figure out how much it is. Again, Google would be a good friend here. It's not part of our slide here, but it depends on, again, how much you're pulling in on an annual basis, basically from retirement income. Yeah, it could determine, if 50% is taxable or 85% or none, right? So that's why it's important to work with a financial professional and a CPA when deciding to take definitely big withdrawals from your retirement. Is there any more? Let's see if I'm missing anything else. I have a
Yeah,
client.
the if a child receives SSI and is now 27, are they eligible to transfer to SSDI under parents' benefits while both parents are living? That's a I think I believe so. I've seen it happen. I believe I've seen it happen. I do have clients that they were just on very little. They didn't even get on the SSI. They're on the Social Security disability because of the parents. But that's a question that I would rather kind of take off. I would rather ask a more detailed question to one of our professionals to work with.
And Mike, I can help with that a little bit. This is Sharon. So
Okay,
you're
Sharon.
talking about collecting under the childhood disability benefit. And in order to do that, you have to be, disabled prior to the age of 22, which it sounds like this person was. But the parent has to either be retired, collecting Social Security, or be deceased. So, that's kind of, there's, what it depends on the parent's situation as to whether you can start collecting under their record. And once you do, then your SSI converts to the SSDI benefit. You get to keep your Medicaid, and sometimes it gets goofed up in the coding system, but know that you are allowed to keep your Medicaid that will follow you as long as you keep your assets below 2000, that SSI limit of 2000. And don't earn any other, type of income, that type of thing. So there's, I have some slides when I do my Social Security disability presentation on that kind of stuff. But that's the basics. And you get Medicare after 2 years of that too. Once you convert over to the SSDI under the childhood disability benefit, and you keep your Medicaid after 2 years, now you'll also collect Medicare. So you'll be Medicare would be primary and then Medicaid. So
I see a question from Diana regarding what is your understanding of the proposed reductions of Social Security and Medicare? Who knows? We just don't know. I don't know any politician who has the guts to make that change at this point in time. Democrat, Republican, I don't think it matters. We don't know what's going to happen as far as that goes. The best thing for anybody to do is start is keep doing the planning. And I feel pretty confident that they're not going to take a 70-year-old and say, we're reducing your benefits. Kind of what Brandon said, I think what's going to happen is they're going to say, a 25-year-old, your full retirement age is going to be 70 or maybe even a little bit older.
Yeah,
But
and one
I don't
other
think
thing.
that's Brandon. Have you seen any, or Sharon, have you seen any hard evidence of what they're planning on doing? Because I haven't.
The one thing I do know, and this is from SSA, is until 2036, they don't have to come out of pocket, for lack of better words, where they're selling off. So to Mike's point, who's going to have the guts to make these decisions? And again, what would happen? Let's pretend nothing changes and it keeps going as it is. And 2036 comes, there would be a 22% reduction to everyone's benefits. That's assuming they did not. So we don't think that's going to happen, right? I think the two major ways they're going to find a way to do this is they're going to increase the full retirement age. And then, also there's limits to, I don't quote me, it's like $165,000 in earned income. And then they stop acting for Social Security. An easy fix would be, hey, we just make that 300,000 or whatever the number is, and they can make this thing solvent for many, many years. So again, not fun because people who make that amount of money don't want to continue to get taxed on their benefits, right? But that is something they'll probably increase that limit from like 165, what it is to today. They could increase that to call it 250, 300, and then they're collecting a lot more income in that respect. So.
Brandon, along those lines, is there a maximum amount that somebody's allowed to have in a Social Security payout?
So there is a maximum amount, right? So there's not like you could be on a, again, I don't have that number for you, Sharon, but you could be the Bill Gates, and you're going to be capped at how much you could be earning from Social Security, right? So typically, if you've been a what we call a max wage earner, and you've met those thresholds, for 30 plus years, 35 plus years of over that threshold, because that 165 number I just told you, Sharon, that increases each year by about $5,000 to $10,000 just because of where we are. But again, somebody again at a billionaire
It's
has been
3822.
$1 million. What is it?
3822 is the max.
There you go.
And then if you wait till age 70, it's 4873.
There you go. So,
Okay.
yep.
Okay. So maybe if they increase the 165 to something else, they would also increase that max amount, but who
They
knows?
could. They could. Yeah,
And
absolutely.
there was a question here about does the eligibility for Medicare change now that the retirement age adjusts? I haven't seen that. It's age 65. So it's not, it has nothing to do with the Social Security at this point in time, your eligibility, your FRA for Social Security. It's age 65 as Medicare.
Yeah, and if most likely you're going to have your Medicare funded by Social Security. If you are the waiting till full retirement age of 67, you would self-fund the Medicare purchase if you decided to turn on Medicare at age 65 for those 2 years before you kicked on Social Security.
Right, but I don't see that as, unless you don't have any other assets or income, I don't see that as a reason why to start taking your Social Security early.
No,
I've
100%.
heard people do that though, and I think it's a big mistake. One thing as far as delaying, I haven't seen anybody, any client that I know that has regretted waiting. They don't tell me that they regret at age 60 taking it at age 62, but when I run their financial plans, I can tell they regret it because it's a huge haircut. And so it's a big decision, and it's one of the most important decisions an individual can make in their financial life, and we're always up to helping out.
Well, Mike and Brandon, that 8% number that you quoted is something that really stuck out to me. So that's kind of one way to look at it is, because you hear people say, oh, start taking it now, you're going to lose out and everything. But you're saying the penalty, the way I understand it, is really 8%.
Yeah, and
So
then
if
it
you saw that
also,
slide, Sharon, if you started at 62, right? And let's pretend your full retirement benefit is $1,000. That's what you're going to get at 67, right? If you turned it on at 62, they give you 70% of that 1,000. So you'd only get $700, right? So on the flip point of that, you get 124% at 870. One of the comments in the chat was very good. I mean, hey, what if I turned it on early and reinvested it, right? That's a great idea. That I'm not. And if you, here's what we find though. People will say they'll do that and then they don't do it, right? And then they don't reinvest it, right? So, but it's illogically, that makes sense. But to Mike's point, in our world, there's not many things in the investment world that we can guarantee 8% on. That's a big increase, right? Now, again, I think the only person, to Mike's point, that's going to regret taking early, it's life history, right? Life longevity, right? Because if you died at 70 and you were waiting till 70, you don't get anything, right? So I can understand both sides of the spectrum, but you know, really consider what your longevity looks like.
Right. And so in the planning process, we kind of go the pros and cons. And again, if you have a survivor, a spouse, it definitely, yes, it makes that decision a little more complicated. I don't know if we mentioned it, but the penalty for, you did, didn't you? You said the penalty for working and being 62 and claiming Social Security was 2-to-1, right?
2-to-1, and you can earn up to 22,000 is the threshold, right?
Okay. Yep. This one makes me feel with that.
I'm looking at Diana's question here real quick. Regarding Part D, if you start Medicare at age 65, but not the Social Security benefit. Well, Part D, you pay, that's the drug coverage, right? So you're paying that out of pocket anyway, right? So my understanding is if you're not collecting Social Security, again, paying that private would what you'd be doing if you added Part D, that which is like basically a supplemental plan.
So, well, so Diana, go ahead, Mike.
No, you go ahead, Diana, Sharon.
So the Part D penalty, I think, is kind of what you're thinking of here. So
yes, it is.
Okay, thank you. When you're Medicare age 65, if you don't have credible coverage through, you know, through some source, and you do not take Part D, the prescription drug plan, you don't have prescription drug plan coverage, and then later on, let's say you go on Medicare at 65, but you don't take the Part D, and then at age 70, and I've had people do this at like age 75 or something, I'm like, oh, I didn't need my prescriptions when I was 65, but now I need them, and so I'm going to pay for the Part D, they're going to penalize you with your premium, so your premium is going to be higher. You know, because you didn't have credible coverage for a period of, you know, when you could have. So the whole key when you're turning 65, you know, is to really, for the insurance, it has really nothing to do with the Social Security. It's all about what is your medical coverage? What kind of coverage are you eligible for? And if you're covered under a group plan, you need to make sure that that group plan meets the criteria as being a credible plan. And those rules have actually changed a little bit from my understanding. And if you're independent on the exchange and stuff like that, you need to make sure that your exchange policies have enough benefits to be considered credible. Because if not, you could be penalized later on when you want to go on to Medicare.
No, thank you, Sharon. And then looking at Marcia's question. Yeah, I see that a lot for like self-employed individuals that are trying to beef up the Social Security benefit for when they retire. Not a bad idea. I think the thing to consider is how will that overall affect the 35 years, right? Because they're basing it off of 35 years of working history. So if you if that 10 years of the next 10 years is pushing you into 40 years of working history, yeah, I mean you'd be eliminating 5 low wage earning years and adding again 5 more where you're high wage earning years. So I think it just depends on what your overall 35 looks like, if that makes sense.
We can all get that information from having an account, online account with socialsecurity.gov. So I encourage you to, you know, have go in and register and get an account at socialsecurity.gov. You can get all your history on your wage earnings and all and your projected retirement earnings at different ages and all that. Is that correct, Mike and Brandon?
That is
Yes.
correct.
Yeah.
Actually,
It's a
Sharon,
great source.
I was going to chime in. I did that while they were talking on the call and logged into my Social Security account, and it showed everything. It showed how much I would make if I retired at 67. So I'm 45. So for me, they tell me I have to retire at 67. And then it also told me what my earnings would be if I waited until 70, but also if I took it early at 62. So to your point, it's very helpful to go to your socialsecurity.gov and log in. But as a heads up, they are switching to the new government login.gov ID for logging into that account.
Yeah, and to piggyback off of what Marsha was asking, they're assuming you're going to make the same amount of money on that, right? So in that example, if you plan on chugging up the next 10 years of earned income, they don't have that factored into those equations, right? They assume that you're going to continue to make the similar amount of income that you've made the previous years, right? So great point. Good call out, Julie.
So, and for you guardians and professionals and stuff too, you can get so much information from Social Security. So we open the trust for you a lot of times, and you know, what kind of government benefits are your clients on? Go, you know, to Social Security, call your you know, and get a benefit verification letter sent out. And that will tell you the history of your client's Social Security. Were they on SSI? When did it convert to SSDI? You know, what, you know, all of that kind of stuff. There is so much information you can get from Social Security if you have, you know, authority to do that. And you should, as a, you know, you should be able to get that, or the rep payee should be able to get that. So I encourage you to do that, please. Awesome. So, are there any more questions? We're just a couple minutes before noon time. And Mike
Good.
and Brandon, do you see any others or any final comments?
Yeah, and if anybody, what was the new login? Oh, Julie mentioned the new login. I would, it's a like a, I think it's like two factor. I would just log in and it walks you through it. It says ID on it. There's two different options. I haven't tried to do it for myself in a while. Is that right, Julie? Do you see
That's
it?
right. There are two different options. It'll tell you, like, if you had an existing Social Security login, which I did, it will tell you to convert it. And then, if since relevant, since we've all been dealing with storms, if you've done any FEMA reporting, you already have this ID login ID thing too. It's what the government's switching to, but it's two-factor. It authenticates to your phone. They're going to ask you some information about you. And then it easily found my Social Security account and put it all together and showed me everything I needed to see. It was very easy.
Yeah, I just put in my contact information, our website, my email, and then our phone number, and just give us a call if you need anything or have questions.
All right. Boy, this was great, Brandon and Mike. Thank you so much for
Thank you for having
presenting
us.
to us today. We really appreciate it. I just thought of something I want to share with everybody because I've gotten two emails from a waiver newsletter that I'm on, and it said that FEMA is providing free tarps for people in affected areas. There's some kind of qualification. I don't know what that is, but just, you know, something to think about. If you have clients that may have been affected, they might be eligible for some kind of free tarping from FEMA if they need it. So, Mike, are you talking?
Does FEMA install the tarp?
No idea. All I did was see an email about here. You can see if you're eligible. So, and I'm happy to forward that email to anybody if they, I'd put my contact information in there before. Okay, our next webinar is, I don't have the date. Well, Julie and Kate, it's the second Wednesday. It's second Wednesday,
I don't
typically.
believe wait, hold on. We have one in November, right? Not because of Thanksgiving.
Yes, November 13th, it's a Wednesday.
Okay.
At this time at 11 o'clock. Right. And I believe I am the speaker, and I'm going to be speaking about different types of special needs trust. So I hope to see you all there. I believe that's my topic. Right. Okay. Julie's shaking her head. Yes. So look for our emails, and thank you so much for joining today. Bye-bye.
Thank you for having us.
Thanks, everybody. It was really nice seeing you all and talking to everybody. Thanks so much, and God bless you guys.